Okay, good evening. Welcome to the Wednesday, October 26, 2016 Board of Education meeting. We have seven board members present, none absent. The board has been in closed session for the appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, since 6:15, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the district or legal counsel for the district, the setting of price for sale or lease of property owned by the district, and the purchase of, or lease of real property for the use of the district, including meetings held for the purpose of discussing whether a particular parcel should be acquired. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I have one public comment for tonight, and I ask that you please speak for 3 minutes. And the first name is Kristen Whitehurst.
Good evening. I'd like to talk about two things today, so I'll try to keep it quick. I see on the agenda that we're going to talk about enrollment projections. So I just wanted to throw a few things out there because we won't have an opportunity to ask questions or to comment once that happens. Last year, the York administration projected an increase of 100 to 105 students for this current year. The district administration projected 60. The answer, the end result was 91. So I just want to throw that out there so that this year, as we're looking toward courses and hiring staffing for next year, that we really take into consideration the numbers that we're getting from York. In just a short time, the people at York are going to be looking at course selections and staffing because they'll start to register for classes in January. And we don't want to have another situation where students have to re-register because classes are cut. And I think we want to make sure that we're not cutting some of these electives that make our school what it is. I think if we start cutting some of these classes like World Studies and International Relations and things like that, then I think we become a mediocre high school, and I don't think we want to be that. So I just ask, as we're looking at these things and making decisions about staffing for next year, that we keep all that in mind. We are also looking at the projections that Chris Welton was going to be presenting, have an additional 87 students for next year. So in addition to the 91 for the current year, we're looking at projection, which again may be low, of 87 students. So we're looking at a significant increase for next year at York. And I just think we need to be aware of that. The other thing, the middle school, I was looking at those enrollment figures. And I'm curious because the population is down, and yet I know that we still have classes in the middle schools with 30 plus students in them. I'm not sure how that is, but I think we really want to take a look at that, because when we have that many students and when we know that there are also a shortage of aides in the district, I think we need to be cognizant of the fact that every student in that classroom is suffering when we have too many students, not enough paraprofessionals. Certainly the students with IEPs and 504s, they're the ones who are hurting the most. But truly, every student is hurting when we have too many kids in a class. The other thing I want to talk about is Focus 205. There's been a lot of conversation about Focus 205 among parents and community members. And I was watching the video from the last meeting where it was stated that maybe people aren't attending and participating a whole lot because they're happy with how things are. I will tell you that there's a great deal of conversation in our district from parents and community members who are involved, the ones who are in the know, who are deeply disappointed in the Focus 205 from last year and this year. And they're very disillusioned. There's just a huge amount of conversation about that things are agenda driven. There's a lot of propaganda. It's very one-sided. For those of you who were at the October 3rd meeting, that came out loud and clear. Almost every table commented about lack of information, lack of context. It just kept coming up over and over again. It came up again on Monday. Parents are felt like they are being talked down to, that they are being treated condescendingly. There's a lot of conversation about drinking the Kool-Aid. One parent even said that he felt like he was at a timeshare sales pitch, and that wasn't a compliment. I think we need to look at this whole procedure that we're doing and look at how information has been presented, just like the middle school survey. Those questions, none of the questions of any of this is providing a complete point of view. It's all very one-sided, and it's not transparent. And just so you know, there are a lot of people who are not happy.
Are there any other public comments? Okay, hearing none, we'll move to those who excel. Okay, those who excel, this is recognition, and if I could have Kara Caforio and Stephen Fihor. How do you say your last name? Fior, okay. Come to the podium, thanks. Thanks for coming. In the front. Okay, so a little bit of an introduction. The Illinois State Board of Education are recognizing these two individuals for their outstanding contributions, and they were nominated by people in our district, and they were awarded this past Saturday. So I'm going to read the proclamation and then say a couple other words. Whereas the Illinois State Board of Education annually recognizes and honors individuals who have made outstanding contributions to public and non-public elementary and secondary education in the fall of each year at the Those Who Excel Awards banquet and program. And whereas Kara Caforio, the Focus 205 facilitating team co-chair, was nominated by Superintendent Dr. David Moyer in the Community Volunteer category of the 42nd Annual ISBE, Those Who Excel Competition. And whereas in a letter of recommendation, Malia Smith stated, we in Elmhurst Community Unit School District 205 are extremely grateful for her tireless efforts on behalf of our students, staff, and community at large. And whereas on October 22, 2016 in Bloomington Normal, Illinois, at the awards banquet and program, Kara was recognized for her efforts by receiving an award of merit. And whereas Stephen Fior, who serves as the physical education teacher at Jackson Elementary School, was nominated in the early career educator category by fellow staff member and librarian Margaret Lewis, as well as by Principal Ryan Anderson. And whereas, as Stephen stated in the professional biography portion of the nomination, when students have a choice in their curriculum, they become motivated to participate in something that interests them. With my background, I can modify instruction to fit the needs of diverse learners and provide skills they can practice to become lifelong movers. And whereas this past Saturday, an ISBE Those Who Excel Award of Recognition was bestowed upon Stephen, and whereas this accomplishment brings pride and prestige to Elmhurst Community Units District 205, to the Focus 205 facilitating team, to Jackson Elementary School, and to the community. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Education Administration of Elmhurst Community Unit School District 205 express deep appreciation and congratulations to Kara and Stephen for their outstanding accomplishments. Yeah. And just wanted to say a few other words. For Kara working on Focus 205, she has really tried to help our district figure out what is a future plan for us. We've been talking about a plan for a long time, and this is a way to get towards a long-term facility plan, and she has been there to help us in a positive way and constructive way. It's very difficult work. there's a lot of different sides, so I just want to thank you for persevering. It's not easy, and I'm glad you were recognized by the Illinois State Board of Education. And then for Stephen, thank you. You teach at my kids' school. They are always talking about how great you are. They love PE. So just as a personal note, thank you, and thanks for helping all those students at the school.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks. Tonight we have our insurance renewal for the calendar year, January through December. I think I first told the insurance broker in May that she would be presenting at the October 25th meeting, and I reminded her again in June, and then August and September, and a few weeks ago, and then when we switched it to Wednesday, I forgot to tell her that we switched the meeting. So this presentation is mine now. Our insurance renewal for the PPO plans, and we have two PPO plans, PPO 1, and then our high deductible plan with the HSA, both those plans are increasing 7.2%. And that is based on the fixed costs and the claims that they are projecting. And they're projecting claims, the medical claims, at 7.5%. The prescription drugs are trending at 13%. And on our HMO plan, the premiums are increasing 3.3%, and that is based on a medical trend of 5% with prescription drugs at 13%. Prescription drugs are, they're projecting that 4 or 5 years from now, prescription drugs are gonna make up 40 to 50% of the health insurance claims. That is one area that is really, I mean, it saves some on medical plans by keeping people out of the hospital and out of the office, but those costs are really increasing. So this next slide, this shows overall, we're projecting an increase of 6% because our dental plan is flat with no increase. But between the PPOs at 7.2 and the HMOs at 3.3 and the dental at 0, that's an overall increase of 6%. These next slides just show the different plans that we have across our staff and what plans the staff are in. And with the 7.2% in the PPO 1, the 7.2% in the high deductible health plan with the HSA, the 3.3, this is the Blue Advantage HMO. This is our lowest cost plan, is the Blue Advantage. And then the HMO Illinois plan, 3.3%. And then in the insurance committee this year, we looked at different plan design options for the PPO1 plan. The PPO1 plan currently is at 102% of the Cadillac tax, 102.91% of the Cadillac tax threshold. So this is, the PPO1 plan is our most generous plan, so we looked at different options to try and minimize that 7.2% increase. We looked at two other options. Option two would have resulted in a 6% increase, and option three would have resulted in a 2.2% increase. These are with higher deductibles and higher out-of-pocket maximums. But the staff voted to continue with the same benefit plan design, so that's the result is the 7.2% on the PPO plans. So that's it on the insurance renewal. So, do we want to move on to the next item?
Chris, could you explain, you said that plan was at 102% of the Cadillac tax. Could you explain
Yes.
the Cadillac tax, when it kicks in, and what implication that would have for the district?
Yeah. So the current Cadillac tax threshold is $850 per month for a single plan. Dave, can you? Yeah. I'm going to have to put my glasses. So currently, the premiums here for the PPO plan are $874.73 per month. That is the single premium right here in the 2017, $874.73. So the Cadillac tax threshold is $850 per month, which is $10,200 per year. So the Cadillac tax is based on premiums, what the premium is for that particular plan. The family is $27,500 annually, or $2,292 per month. So currently, if the Cadillac tax is implemented in 2020, the PPO plan will have a tax of $855,000 for the school district. Currently, the high deductible plan is at 74% at the single rate and 78% for family. Where if I go back to the PPO, the family's at 94.75%. The high deductible plan, we're at 74.12% for single, 78% for family. The HMO Blue Advantage plan is at 65.5% and 58.74% for family. And the HMOI is 71.8% and 63.07%. So the high deductible plan, the Cadillac tax won't hit till 2022. That is assuming where it projects the premiums to go up at like 8%. And then the Blue Advantage plan won't hit the Cadillac tax until 2025. And the HMOI won't hit the Cadillac tax till 2023. So the biggest concern related to the Cadillac tax right now is the PPO1 plan.
So when does the Cadillac, I know it's been extended more than once, the deadline.
2020.
So clearly, we need to keep that premium under $850 a month. Is that right?
That is what, in order to avoid the Cadillac tax, that's what we need to do, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I can't imagine our taxpayers paying the Cadillac tax. That's either got to be shared by the employees, or we need to structure the plan so that we don't hit that federally mandated threshold.
Yeah, so that was why we spent a lot of time in September talking about different plan design options, and we looked at it, and the staff voted, and at this time, they voted to not make any plan design changes. But we'll be talking about this in the insurance committee throughout the year.
So the longer that plan structural changes are delayed, then once 2020 comes, the bigger that change is going to have to be.
That is correct.
Okay. Thank you.
And certainly, you know, when you look at medical benefits trending at 13% and 7%, and then when we look at our property tax levy tonight, we're estimating a 2.42% in our extension increase, which is 85% of our revenues. Certainly, this benefit area, when you look at our financial projections, where benefits represent about 13-14% of our expenditures, it's definitely a concern moving forward for financial sustainability.
I agree.
So the next presentation is the tax levy. The initial part of this, I know the board is very aware of the different components related to the tax levy, the EAV, the tax rates, tax cap formula, consumer price index, new construction, and then the levy. The levy is a request by the school district for a certain amount of revenue to be generated by the property tax. This request is sent to the county clerk prior to the last Tuesday in December. The extension is the process in which the clerk determines the tax rate needed to raise the revenue. It's certified by each taxing district in the county, the actual dollar amount billed to property taxpayers in the district. So the extension is the total of all property tax bills. New construction, that's new improvements or additions to existing improvements on any parcel of real property that increases the assessed value of the real property during the levy year. It does not include maintenance and repairs. When completing the levy, we don't know how much new construction we will have. And so this, when we do the levy, we need to estimate what we think new construction will be, because new construction is exempt from the tax cap, the property tax extension limitation law. The tax cap does not cap individual property tax bills or individual property tax assessments. The tax cap allows a taxing district to receive a limited inflationary increase in tax extensions on existing property plus an additional amount for new construction. The tax cap is the lesser of CPI or 5%, but this limitation does not apply to new construction, which allows taxing bodies to recoup their fair share of tax revenue from that new property. The debt service, bond, and interest payments are outside the tax cap. CPI this year for this levy is 0.7%. That's the fourth year in a row of declining CPIs, and Well, it's fourth year where we're below 2%. Those are historical low CPI numbers. The average for the past 5 years is 1.54%. CPI is the price level of market basket of consumer goods. This is our tax levy timeline. The 0.7% CPI came out this past January. Now with the board, it says November, it's actually October 26th, that the board approves the tentative levy, and then in December, the board will approve the final levy, will file with the county, and then in late March, the final EAV and tax extensions are completed by the county. June 1st, the bills come out for the first installment, and then the second installment will be in September. This just shows the relationship between existing EAV, tax rate, and CPI. Right now, the EAV is increasing, which means our tax rate will be decreasing. For many years, 2008 through 2014, the EAV was going down and the tax rates were going up. Now we've turned that around. Last year, EAV went up, and again, we're projecting EAV to go up again. So that will mean the tax rate will go down. So we have this inverse relationship we just talked about between EAV and tax rate. So that the tax rate does not equal the property tax bill increase. So determining this year's levy, we know we've got the 0.7 CPI. We don't know what EAV, where that's going to come in, and we don't know new construction. But we are estimating at this time EAV to increase 8%. I was able to get estimates from Addison Township at about 8.25%, and York Township EAV estimates at about 7.5%. So right now we're estimating EAV to increase 8%. New construction EAV, these are past ones. You can see that we were at about 20 million up to 33 million in 14, 35 million there in 15. So we are estimating new construction EAV at 40 million. Just an estimate. I was not able, well, I did, Addison Township was able to give me an estimate at about 4.2 million. York Township did not have theirs finalized, so they could not give me an estimate. So we're estimating it at 40 million. For this levy, in addition to the 40 million that we are estimating, we're gonna levy for an additional 25 just in case there's the possibility that we don't want to underestimate new construction, so we inflate that number. But no matter what the district levies, the county will only extend the increase allowable under the tax cap. The levy is just a request. So this is where we show what we're levying here. The levy, the operating cap funds, the levy is an increase of 3.5%. The bond and interest levy increase is 2.09. Overall, the levy is a 3.35% increase over last year's extension. The final column to the right, this is with where we're estimating new construction at 40 million. So we actually think that the capped funds will increase 2.42%, even though we're levying 3.5%. And the overall increase that we are estimating is 2.5%, even though we're levying 3.35%. The past 5 years, the actual extension increase is about 1.11%, has been 1.1% less than the levy increase. So we always levy we end up levying for an additional amount, and it ends up being less than what we actually levy. We're estimating if you have no new construction at all, and you have a $300,000 house, you're generally the capped amount will be the CPI plus the bond and interest, and that's an average increase of 1.05% or $53. Zillow has the average home price in Elmhurst at $371,900. On this house with just existing property and no new construction, it will increase by 1.05% or $66. That's it for the tax levy. We'll have the final levy in December, the December board meeting.
Okay, any questions? This is routine. Thanks.
So the next item that I have tonight is the enrollment projections. Enrollment projecting is not an exact science. There's a lot of factors that come into it. These projections are based on the modified cohort or on the cohort survival method. We don't estimate early childhood. We just, with the early childhood program, those are 3 and 4 year olds, we just keep those flat. That's the same thing that the demographer, the professional demographer did when he came in. But the Madison enrollment has it increased by 20 students to 288 this year from 268 the year before. And over the past 5 years, Madison has increased by about 43%. So Madison has been experiencing enrollment growth. Kindergarten is the next hardest to project, and I used the demographer's projections for kindergarten, all except Field and Jackson. The demographer has been pretty far off on both Field and Jackson, so I modified the kindergarten projection somewhat at both Jackson and Field. At Jackson, he had projected about 50 kids for all 5 years, and they've been the last 3 years been about 70 to 73, 69, 67, and 73. So I increased the kindergarten numbers at Jackson from what the demographer had 50s, and I raised it to 65, 64, 63, 62, 61. So I changed the demographer's kindergarten numbers at Jackson just because he seemed like he was way too low there. And at Field, was the opposite thing that's been happening. He was in the 70s, and they've been coming in. They were at 49, 60, 59. So I lowered those from the 70s down to 64. Other than that, we used the cohort survival method of projecting. And in the K-5 level, we are projecting for next year it increased by 0.6% last year. And the 6 to 8 decreased 1.15%. And from 1,993 to 1,970. And at the York High School, the enrollment went up by 91 students, 3.44% increase. But what else did I want? Ooh, we've had this bubble coming through, and the larger class sizes are in 7th, 8th, 9th, and 11th grade. And that's why we experienced this peak at the 6 to 8 level last year at 1,993, and now we are projecting the middle schools to decrease, and we are projecting the high school to increase because of that, those larger class sizes in 7th, 8th, 9th, and 11th. So we're projecting York High School to go up to 2,900 in the year 2019-20, in 3 years. Bryan is projected to be our largest middle school, and it's projected to continue to increase as Sandburg and Churchville are projecting decreases. The field increases that we've been projecting really haven't started yet. We still, the 56 new homes, I think, is about half occupied now, and we haven't experienced the large increases related to the 56 homes yet. So the field is projected to increase 3, 4, 5 years out, but not in the next couple of years. Jackson is projected to increase, and it's going to get a little tight at Jackson, where we're projecting 19 additional students next year, 28 after that. So Jackson is projecting, has been increasing, and is projected to increase some more over the next 3 years.
This may be a dumb question, but you know, Lincoln is always on our radar for its needs, and Field obviously is too. So is Jackson now creeping onto your radar? I mean, is this now need to be part of the conversation for future facility planning? And I mean, I think that caught everyone by surprise, didn't it? The increase in the last few years, is that part of the discussion now since they're quickly running out of space?
Definitely. I mean, fortunately, Lincoln has gone down. We had 584 in 2011-12, and this year we were at 540. So Lincoln has gone down. As back in 12-13 when I was here, I was very concerned about Emerson and Fisher, and both of them fortunately have gone down. I would say that Jackson is definitely our, we're more concerned about the space at Jackson now than certainly, and Hawthorne has gone down quite a bit. Hawthorne and Emerson both have decreased by about 100 students. So yeah, Jackson has probably become our biggest concern from a space issue now at the elementary level.
Chris, I am trying to put these enrollment figures with the information that we got on Monday from the Focus 205 on the particularly one piece where they had student per square footage. And as I recall, the student per square footage, Jackson was in good shape.
Was it?
Yeah, so that's what I'm trying. This seems to be a, I'm trying to put those pieces together.
Rhoda, I was at Bryan, and there was an explanation for that.
Perfect.
If The library, multipurpose room, auditorium, gym, if those rooms are large, or cafeteria, that all counts towards the square footage. So it doesn't mean classrooms. It's the overall square footage of the building. So some of those larger rooms could make Jackson fit into that target area. But that doesn't mean you'd have an adequate classroom.
Okay. So that is...
I mean, I don't want to scare anybody to say we don't have enough room next year at Jackson. I believe we are fine for classrooms next year. I'm just saying it's coming on our radar. And we're being proactively looking forward, looking 3 years out, you know, and trying to plan accordingly. It's not... I think we're going to be fine for classroom space at Jackson next year. I don't want to cause any alarms right now. It's just, it's going up 19 students next year. So I don't want anyone to get too panicky about this.
Just real world, you know, experience. So in the past, Jackson's been kind of a three-section school, and now the second grade has four sections, first grade has four sections, and there's every reason to believe that next year it will be the same because the kindergarten numbers are large. So there have already been classrooms that were devoted to other things that are not classrooms. So, I mean, they're a real risk of having, I think my son is in what used to be the music room. You know, I mean, now they're doing art in a cart, music on a cart. It's those kind of things that happen. It's not that there's no room. It's just that they're really having to change the way they're teaching instruction.
And I appreciate that. And I know a lot of these conversations are probably based off of where you are. So I was at the Churchville presentation, and obviously there was concern that the Churchville, there weren't these extra spaces. So there wasn't an auditorium. There wasn't, you know, all of these large multi-use facilities for Fisher and for Emerson. So those were some of the concerns that were expressed. And I don't know how you fit all of those pieces into the puzzle, but I think somehow we need to have a conversation about what that square foot per student looks like, what our enrollment looks like, put all those pieces together. And I don't know if it's real or perceived, but those are some of the conversations that were occurring, I know particularly at my table and as I was walking out talking to other people, concerns that they had.
Chris, do you know what off the top of your head, what the theoretical capacity of Jackson and York are, and then what in our projections here, what the highest number of enrolled students in each of those schools is going to be? I mean, York, it's clear, 2,900.
I don't have the capacity figures with me tonight. We have them. We had put some of them in the facility at a glance booklet last year, and we'll be working on the revised facilities at a glance booklet, and we'll take a closer look now at send these projections to Frank so that he could look at capacity compared to the new enrollment projections.
Okay. Yeah, when you get a minute, mm-hmm. If you could let us know what those are.
I think mine is related, Chris, was York. I mean, if we're talking about 2020 having 2,900 students, you know, what was our largest class that we've had?
In history?
Well, no, with the facilities that we have. Like, we've never been up at 2,900.
No, but I believe that the capacity at York can handle the 2,900. I believe we're going to have to put some new lockers at York over the next few years. But I do believe that the renovated New York can handle the 2,900 students. Now, they're going to have to utilize the building in some places a little differently, but... I do believe it has the capacity for 20.
This is when Jim says back in my day. Go ahead.
I completely exercise the self-control from not by not saying that. But if you insist, when I attended York, there were 4,000 kids and 2,400 chairs. So
in a smaller building.
But now my question is, York has some unrenovated space. I'm curious, are we ever in the proximity of having to consider renovating that unrenovated, unoccupied space, which is presently at York?
I do not anticipate that at this time. I think we can utilize the space for the 2,900. The rooms may have to be used a little differently in order to do that, but I believe that we can use our current configuration for that many.
The other question that I had was around Madison. I know that was difficult for the demographer to project, and so that's why you say that, you know, it's not necessarily projection. You have Madison enrollment increase of 7.46%, and then over the last 5 years, it's 43%. Are we tracking which buildings those students are going to? And is that why some of our elementary schools, such as Jackson, have the higher numbers moving into the schools? Wondered if there was a correlation there. And more curious than anything about how we do that.
Chris, let me take that one. I don't believe there's a correlation there for this reason. We've been seeing some increasing poverty and more kids that are qualifying under the guidelines for that program. So the students were in our community going to our schools anyway, but more of them now are qualifying for the early childhood program.
And then the question is, what schools are they moving into after Madison is the question that I had.
I have not been tracking that. I'm sure that Susan and the teachers at Madison, I know that they talk. Or Kathy, go ahead.
Chris, if I could just respond to that. Yes, Susan knows as soon as they enter based on their address, and we track that. Many of the students are already identified for special education services, but even if they're only receiving services through at-risk or English language, we do know which kindergarten they're going into, and that's communicated to each of those building principals.
I guess bottom line, my point is, as you said, in the past, other schools have been a concern for you, but now it seems to be Jackson as one of them, saying, well, I don't know why the projections are wrong. It could be because we don't project for Madison, and they could be coming into those buildings. Whatever.
I think the thing is that the school that those students would have gone to, they would have gone to anyway. And so, do you get what I'm saying? Okay.
Yeah. Were included in the projection.
I'm not a technical person, so if you could dumb it down for me, I'd appreciate it. What I heard you say is, you know, in early childhood, we kind of have to just wait and see. And I heard you say, and except for Field and Jackson, you use cohort survival. How do you adjust the cohort survival for those two buildings based on what?
Well, it starts with the kindergarten.
You're looking at how many kindergartners move into first grade, so each cohort meeting, you're looking at kids from one grade to the next over the last 3 to 5 years. How many increase? So it's difficult to know the 3 and 4 year olds that are at risk at Madison. It's hard to project that because it's just 3 and 4 year olds with at risk, you know, meeting that criteria is just really hard to project. Again, kindergartners, are hard to project because, you know, you don't have experience. Where first grade, second grade, all those, you're using historical trend of cohort survival ratios.
But you said at Field of Jackson, you're adjusting the cohort.
I adjusted, not the cohort, I adjusted the demographer. We had that professional demographer come in. He was looking at census data for each of the boundaries of, he was looking at the age of, you remember that presentation where he was looking at the age of the parents of all of the houses, households in each boundary and coming to a conclusion about kindergartners based on how many people who can be parents in that area. You remember that presentation? Yeah. we use his for kindergarten because it's hard, but he was so far off at Field and Jackson that I felt like I couldn't continue to use 50 for Jackson kindergarten when we're seeing 69, 68, and 73. I just felt like if I did 50 again, you know, it just seemed like that's going to throw it off, and it was the opposite, I feel.
And so you're using the two, how many years has it been since he's been here? 2 years?
3 or 4 years.
Three or four. So you're using that, how much he was off using census data and just extrapolating forward from that. Is that what you're?
Yeah, okay. It's certainly not exact science, but I'm being transparent about it.
Yeah. No, I appreciate I was just curious as to how you got there.
I struggled with it, but I thought I cannot continue to use 50 when he's
right.
getting
no.
70
no, no.
every year in kindergarten at Jackson.
And then there was some anticipation that Field, or the way you said it before, was that Field would be experiencing some growth because of 55 new houses, but we don't know what it'll be because of this. And that approach of adjusting, well, I guess maybe you just take new census data. I mean, how do you do that?
Well, you remember that presentation as well as I do. He had projected one per household, 56 kids, and
as I recall, he was very anecdotal this point in particular. Those houses are big. Thank you.
So he was suggesting that one student per household, 56 students, was what he said we would get out of that development. And part of what he said, and maybe he said it to me aside from what he said at the board meeting, the large houses, that the people buying them, they would have older children or they might be going to private schools, but it was based on his experience in other districts and other parts of the country with, you know, affluent or high costing houses was not going to result in large number of young elementary students.
His anecdotal approach should meet my really bad statistical approach of the 16 new homes built in our three block stretch. We were a lot more than one per. So, but we probably should track what's occurred. I mean, we have a pretty good case study to make to the folks doing development in the city of Elmhurst so that we could make our case that these things do have impacts. That was just a statement. That wasn't a question. Sorry.
Well, the enrollment since the demographer study at Field have been, the enrollment has been a lot less than what he projected in each year so far.
I appreciate that, but there is some anticipation that new home thing will be a delayed response than a... I mean,
I would think so.
The thing that didn't add up, maybe it's anecdote versus anecdote, is that these people are moving in with older children, whereas we just need to look out on the front sidewalk.
I was going to say.
See, yeah. That's a little different.
They're moving as preschoolers and they're pregnant. And that's, right. So that's what you mean by the delayed
right.
results. Yes.
Right.
Yeah. So I don't want the public to think we don't get it. We get it. When, as soon as he said it, we kind of knew that probably wasn't going to be the case. Yeah. We took it, but we also, in the back of our mind, said we think he may be wrong. And that's what we're also seeing. It's not like we're not expecting yeah. there to be an increase from the 56 homes.
And your reliance on his methods and his approach is well-grounded. It's just that on this one particular point, I think some of us had an experience that varied from what he was telling us. That's all.
That being said, he has been, his projections for field were much higher than what we've gotten so far.
I need to check one last thing. It's just context and it's not a question. Just correct me when I say this wrong. Just kind of why we're talking about this, and it's why did we have these two items on the agenda to start with? And we just wrapped up budget for 16-17, and these are the initial inputs to budget for 17-18. And at this time of year, we look at the levy on the revenue side, which is 80% of our revenue is property taxes, and we look at enrollment on the cost side
85.
Because 80 plus percent of our costs are people.
80% staffing.
And so these are the major inputs. And then we have discussions like this around capacity and things that we need to watch out for, but this will also flow into a updated 5-year outlook and then some preliminary budgeting for 17-18. And we'll start to get first looks at this. The important part of this is that as we gain more information and data around people that register, people that move in, there'll be other facts that come into this as we go down the road on the budget for next year that we're starting now, and that will be added and the degree of precision will increase. Right now we're trying to do a preliminary high level budget at first step, mainly to answer the question about whether we need to make any cuts or not, because there's a contractual obligation to notify staff if we're going to make cuts. Knock on wood, we're not making cuts for budget reasons this year, and in which case then the process will continue as we refine our assumptions as we move down the road. So this is an important conversation for us to have, but at the same time, it's not supposed to be predictive. It's supposed to give us kind of directional guidance on how the budget's going to start roughing out for next year. And I don't know if you want to add anything to that or correct any of that, Chris. But
yes, this is, as you were saying, this is definitely the first part of the budgeting process. And following this, we started looking at staffing for next year. But it seems like we're always ahead of the budgeting process. And what goes into the projections, the projection model that PMA uses is the audited figures, which they are just getting, which the auditor will present in December. But the audited figures, this year's budget, they look at the enrollment projections. All of these go into our 5-year forecast, which all then go into the 17-18 budget for next year. But staffing, we will be considering these enrollment projections as we look at staffing for next year, and Jim is going to start working on that very soon.
And so we're doing this earlier because we've spent a lot of time over the last few years trying to back this up earlier to now, which also adds degrees of kind of more estimation into it. But the last thing we want is where we were before, where you find out in February that you got to do layoffs in March and you're scrambling around to figure out what's going on. So we're going to sacrifice a little bit of that precision to get us directionally correct earlier so that we have time to plan.
Right.
Okay, thank you. Chris, the Finance Committee meeting? Chris Bloom. Okay.
So he's always free to correct me. We had a finance committee meeting. A couple things we'll just touch on briefly here. September 2016 monthly financial reports. Again, Chris, correct me if I mischaracterize this, but it's pretty much as expected, with the caveat that the state has fallen one more payment behind now. So there are two payments behind?
Correct. The we have not yet, and I'm not talking about the September 30th financials at this point, I'm saying as of today, we have not received the payment from the state, the quarterly mandated categorical payment that was due in June. Last year, we got that June payment in July, 1 month behind, where it's October 26th, and we still have not received that fourth quarter from last fiscal year payment yet. So yes, we have not received that one or the September payment. So we are two quarterly payments behind.
And each payment's about $1.2 million. But beyond that, the financials are tracking as expected.
Yes.
You know, the remaining part of the meeting was spent mainly on our long-term capital maintenance planning. As you may know, we do this, again, as part of the budget process, and Frank brings us a spreadsheet that shows things going out for the next 10 years.
10 years, and it's generally roofs and parking lot, paving, maintenance type items.
Yes, and so we spent time talking about that. I think Frank is going to bring us an actual plan for the summer projects in November, December. One of the next few meetings. I'll cut to the chase on that. 2017 isn't really interesting as one project. It's the roof at York, which is going to cost approximately $1.2 million. Is that?
That's in the admin building, not the entire building, just the academic wing.
So that's all you get for 1.2 million?
Yes.
Okay. And so that will basically take up the entire budget that we had 1.3 million, if you recall, put aside there. We will, I think, more than likely need to move money into the capital fund to cover the cost of these projects. You may recall that we had intended to fund those projects out of the TIF distributions, and they've become unreliable and in some cases just flat out not provided. So we'll have to fund it somehow. And if you don't fund your maintenance, you're just kicking the can down the road to somebody else. So that is an absolute operating cost. It's not optional. What we did ask Dave for on top of that is, so having provided for that funding, if the city did decide to honor its commitment and its promise to distribute these TIF funds as they have in multiple conversations over the course of the last 6 to 9 months, that somehow now has changed, what would we do to catch up? What things could we catch up on? And so we've asked Frank to provide the board at the upcoming meeting where he talks about capital projects with that. I think the main one that we started talking about is if the city were to give us the money, we may be able to do Churchville's parking lot, which is, I think, the one thing that kept coming up, but there may be others that go into that bucket. But that was kind of the main gist of the meeting. So anybody's got questions?
I just want to state we're meeting on Wednesday to discuss that and put together some of those items that you requested at the last Finance Committee meeting.
Questions for the Finance Committee? Okay, thanks. Approval of board meeting minutes. There are three sets of minutes from 2016, September 22nd, September 27th, October 11th. Are there any proposed revisions for the minutes? Okay, hearing none. The minutes will stand as presented. Superintendent's consent agenda. Would any board member like to remove an item from the consent agenda?
I'll move that we approve the superintendent's consent agenda items A through C as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, moved by John, seconded by Jim. Any roll call vote?
Mr. McDonough?
Yes.
Mr. Collin?
Yes.
Dr. Harrell?
Yes.
Ms. Bastido?
Yes.
Mrs. Stufen?
Yes.
Mr. Bloom?
Yes.
Mrs. Ebner?
Yes. Seven ayes, no nays. Motion passes. Superintendent's action items.
The organizational goals were discussed at the Performance Management Committee meeting and then at the last full board meeting. And so these reflect the conversation last time. And so we're just recommending that the board actually approve these so that we can use them in our planning and decision-making process and moving forward.
Any discussion? Okay, go ahead.
I make a motion that the Board of Education approve the organizational goals as presented.
I'll second.
Okay. Moved by John, seconded by Chris. Is there further discussion?
I just want to say thanks for getting that point in there. I think it really is an important one to me, and I think to all of us, and I think it reflects very much, and you guys did a great job and put together a really nice piece there. Thank you.
Anything else? Okay, all in favor of the organizational goals, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay, motion passes. Approval of administrative reorganization proposal.
Okay, for this proposal, we're not asking for additional administration. Kathy Baker, one of our coordinators, is retiring. And what we would like to do is reorganize how we manage our operations in a way that we think will be more effective. And it would be, it would not be more expensive, it would be cost neutral. We have built capacity at the building levels through the use of instructional coaches. And so when we were first getting tech off the ground, Kathy Baker was very much a part of that and served that purpose very well. But we've kind of been able to meet a lot of the needs at the building level differently now, and actually that model allows for more timely meet the needs of the teachers in a more timely manner because the people are right there on a daily basis. So what we would like to do is restructure, add an assistant superintendent rather than replace a coordinator. And the reasons that we put in the proposal, I'll just highlight a couple of the ones that I think are very important. One is that with one assistant superintendent for learning and teaching, we have a really significant span of control or span of supervision that makes it difficult for her to serve everybody that she needs to, from the coordinators to the principals to the various different committees that she works with. Just because there's just so much responsibility for one position. The second thing is that we're trying to build leadership, and a coordinator serves a different type of support role than an assistant superintendent would. And we're trying to create the ability to support our principals better than we currently are able to do. We also, with as you know, Aaron's background in STEM and kind of the future direction of education and the jobs that are out there and a lot of the things that we've been talking about and will continue to talk about, a lot of the different types of things that we're looking at down the road involve career pathways, and a lot of those involve community partnerships. They involve internships, potential articulated agreements with various agencies outside of the district, whether that's business or education. And also there are a lot of grants out there for STEM-related types of programming that we're currently not actively pursuing. And so we would like to maintain a concept where we don't silo the two positions. So there would be communication. We want to preserve a true unit district type of concept. But we do want to provide that support at the upper grade levels for STEM-related types of things. So we would reorganize some of the existing coordinator responsibilities and some of the existing assistant superintendent responsibilities to include some grade level responsibilities, but we don't want to call it like an assistant for elementary and an assistant for secondary, because we don't want to create that structure where there's that kind of perception of a separation in our operation. So, but some of that is built in for different reasons. We listed in the proposal, I think, relatively thorough rationale. So I don't think I want to read, you know, three pages here, but those are some of the big things that I wanted to just highlight that were part of the part of our reasoning that went into why we would like to do structure our administrative staff differently.
Is there just any questions for the proposal?
I move that the Board of Education approve the administrative reorganization proposal as presented.
Is there a second?
I'll sec.
Okay, moved by John, second by Emily. Yeah, I wanted to reiterate, this is a cost neutral proposal.
Yes, we would just some details. We'd post a position right away and, you know, get that process going, because it's technically, even though we're not adding administration, because it's technically a new position, that's why we have to ask you for approval. But from a cost standpoint, Kathy's retirement salary in her last year is actually more likely, but at the very least, it's going to be a wash. So you are correct that it will not add money into administrative salary.
So the question that I have is around, I know that you've wanted to have, you know, district office people working at the building level, and there, you know, to be more integration. And so I'm trying to get a sense of, it looks as though that's what this proposal is doing, because we're implementing a lot of things at the building level, and therefore they need the support, and we need to be working, I'm going to call it lockstep, from, you know, district office and building, almost from like the way that some, the programs have been created have been bottom up, meaning the people that are in the classrooms are the ones that have been working on the projects, ELA, you know, STEM, all these sorts of things. So what it does is it allows, I'll call it like incubator, right? You know, you're in organically in the classroom. What do they need? What do we need? The teams come together, and then we're having district office, even in those teams, work together with buildings, right? Teachers and support people. And this is even having an organizational structure that is in alignment with that. Meaning the assistant superintendent is doing more professional development, even at the building level, with the building level, you know, hearing, you know, what are our employees saying at the building level? What do they need? You know, how do we, it's the feedback loop that John talked about at the last meeting. It's more even ongoing, not just formal feedback once a year, that sort of thing. That's kind of what I'm reading into that, but am I reading more into it?
Well, I would say this. I think you're right in that our goal is to support the building, and we're trying to find ways to support the buildings as best we can. And with what we're trying to do with STEM programming, what we're trying to do with the reorganization at the middle school, with what we're trying to do with curricular implementations that are going to require us to provide high quality staff development, have high quality school improvement plans. We are trying to support our buildings, but the way this is a little bit different is we've got instructional coaches supporting teachers. This would be a way to help support the coherence of the system by giving, by helping provide support for the principals to make sure that we're serving the teachers as effectively as we can. And right now, sometimes we find ourselves scrambling a little bit to do that. Mary, if you want to comment, certainly you can feel free, because I didn't make this up without her help. But
no, I think you're right, Dr. Moyer. It's going to allow us to have our coordinators working directly with our teacher teams as they do curriculum development. Our coaches are working with teachers. As assistant superintendent level positions, we really have that opportunity to coach and mentor principals, as well as bring some consistency across all of our systems.
I think just the last piece I'll add, just from a management perspective, I think we just approved a set of goals, and that's what we hold you accountable for. I think it's only fair, and you deserve to be able to build and manage the team. I appreciate you sharing this with us. We're going to hold you accountable for those goals, and trust that you're going to hire the team to do that. And so, I really appreciate the rationale. I think it's well thought out, but I'm not the guy running the district, and you're the one on the hook. So, good luck.
That's reassuring.
Thank you. I'll take it.
Okay, we have a voice vote. Oh, all in favor of the administrative reorganization proposal, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That motion passes. Approval of resolution regarding the estimated amounts necessary to be levied for the year 2015. 16. Motion.
I move that the Board of Education approve the resolution regarding the estimated amounts necessary to be levied for the year 2016 and the notice of the proposed tax increase for publication in the Elmhurst Press.
Sorry. Moved by Karen, seconded by Jim. Any discussion? We heard from Chris Walton.
I just like that it's a little bit lower for our community.
I just want to clarify. I mean, the rate is lower.
Thank you.
Okay, the levy is not.
I said for the community
taxpayers. No, I think what she's saying is that the increase is lower than the increase has been in the past.
1.05%. Yeah. Okay. The roll call vote.
Mrs. Stupin?
Yes.
Mr. Collins?
Yes.
Mr. Bloom?
Yes.
Dr. Harrell?
Yes.
Mr. McDonough?
Yes.
Ms. Bastido?
Yes.
Mrs. Ebner?
Yes. 7 ayes, no nays, a motion passes. Approval of medical and dental insurance contract. Is there a motion?
I move that the Board of Education approve the renewal of the Blue Cross Blue Shield health and dental insurance plans for the January 1st, December 31st, 2017 year as presented.
I'll second.
Okay, moved by Margaret, seconded by Emily. Any further discussion? Okay. Roll call.
Dr. Harrell?
Yes.
Ms. Bastido?
Yes.
Mr. McDonough?
Yes.
Mrs. Stufen?
Yes.
Mr. Bloom?
Yes.
Mr. Collins?
Yes.
Mrs. Ebner?
Yes. 7 ayes, no nays, the motion passes. Approval of English Language Arts Instructional Materials.
These were presented to you at the last board meeting. So they've been on display. Actually, it might have been two board meetings ago, but we had a presentation on this. They've been on display. We're asking your approval so that we can continue to move forward.
Motion, go ahead.
I move that the Board of Education adopt the instructional materials recommended to support the newly approved English Language Arts curriculum.
I'll second.
Okay, moved by Emily, seconded by John. Is there discussion? Go ahead.
I have one question. Do we track how many people come and actually look at these materials?
Yes. The answer is zero. In this case. I think we might have had one this time, I think. I'm not positive on that. But typically, unless it's something that involves a highly controversial type of thing, somebody sees a novel that sticks out to them or something like that, rarely do people come and look at them.
So, is that just a fact of life, or is there a better way to engage the public in the materials that we're going to introduce in our schools?
Well, I mean, maybe both. I mean, I think everywhere I've been, that's pretty much been a fact of life. But for example, when we started the math curriculum development process, we had that community night. And there are different types of things, I suppose, that depending on the nature of what we're doing, we could do. Typically, though, it's been teachers that have done a lot of the curriculum work and have made a lot of the recommendations on those types of things. And then we just, you know, follow the law and display them. So.
Okay. This is a voice vote. Okay, all in favor of the English Language Arts instructional materials, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That motion passes. Approval of donation for Churchville.
The Churchville donation is an electronic sign that will be displayed in the main entrance area. It's similar to the sign that was recently installed at Bryan, for those of you that maybe recall that. So it's a message board. It's a welcoming thing. You can put announcements on there. It's $4,700. And I just want to refer here to my notes quickly. So it was donated by a Churchville PTA. And I think I covered everything else.
Is there a motion? Go ahead.
I move that the Board of Education approve the acceptance of the donation from Churchville Middle School in an amount not to exceed $4,700 for a flat panel TV, mount, and miscellaneous supplies for digital signage. I also want to be sure we thank the Churchville PTA for this generous donation.
I second the motion.
Moved by Margaret, seconded by Karen. Do you want to?
Oh, the only thing that I would add is I love the fact that the point that Churchville wants to use the signage for its digital showcase of students' work, which is fabulous.
Roll call vote.
Dr. Harrell?
Yes.
Mrs. Stufen?
Yes.
Mr. Collins?
Yes.
Mr. Bloom?
Yes.
Mr. McDonough?
Yes.
Ms. Bastido?
Yes.
Mrs. Ebner?
Yes. 7 ayes, no nays, the motion passes. Action on closed session item, we don't have an update on student residency. Superintendent's communication. Principal professional development update.
Okay, our last meeting, we did some work with the professional capital book and chapter 2, competing views of teaching, and our facilitators were Dr. Anderson, Jason Crockett, Peter Cunningham, Ryan Doherty, Linda Fehrenbacher, and Jeff Gale. And we also had did some work that was led by Kathy Baker and Dave Beatty on future-ready learning, and we studied the rigor rubric from the rigor and relevance framework. And as we do these things, we try to model different types of cooperative structures, the Kagan structures, or other types of adult learning types of activities that principals can then take back to their buildings to use when they work with their faculties. Also, at the grade level meetings, principals reviewed the KPI data that's going to be presented to you in November. We had to push that back because we didn't get complete school report card information as quickly as we would like, and Charles couldn't be here tonight because of the change of the board meeting. So you're going to see that information, but our principals reviewed that, talked about inter-rater reliability with teacher evaluation, and took a look at some of the initial data from our first our instructional rounds that we did that was focused on learning targets. So that was that's kind of an update on some of the work we've been doing with our principals. And then I have a statement that I need to read here for you. So let me get that. Elmhurst Community Unit School District 205, like many districts around the country, is working to accommodate the needs of students who are transgender and the privacy interests of all students. The district is and will be making its decisions based on existing District Policy 710, Equal Educational Opportunities, state and federal law, and emerging court decisions. Particularly given the current unsettled state of the law, the district expects to deal with these issues on a case-by-case, building-by-building basis, primarily as guided by Board Policy 710 on equal educational opportunities and the privacy interests of all involved. The district will take these issues into consideration in its planning process for future facility projects and budget cycles. Potential changes will be designed to achieve cost efficiency, enhanced supervision, safety and privacy for all students, and consistency with the master facility plan now under development for the entire district. And finally, we have our Freedom of Information. We had several requests this time, six of them. One regarding purchase orders, which was granted. One regarding EpiPens, which was granted. One regarding copier contracts, which was granted. Actually, we only have five. Not six. One regarding payroll information, which was granted. Two regarding, maybe we do have six. Two regarding job-related issues, which were also granted.
Okay, we're at board communications. I'd like to read a statement on behalf of the Board of Education regarding future stormwater projects. In an October 20th, 2016 letter from the city, from the Elmhurst city manager, the city proposed to purchase a 1.6 acre portion of the Bryan Middle School site for $1.1 million to be developed into a stormwater detention facility. After careful consideration, the Board of Education has reached a consensus that the city's October 20th proposal is inadequate. Under that proposal, the district would have no place to which to transfer its current storage and maintenance operations on the Bryan parcel, very little to pay for the acquisition and improvement of another site for its current Bryan operations, and no compensation for its loss of the long-term future use of the Bryan parcel for school expansion. It is the district's understanding that the city has another project opportunity on a comparably sized parcel for which the city has contracted with the Messiah Lutheran Church immediately south of the Bryan site. The district and city have been negotiating an agreement under which the district would have received about an acre of land from the city adjacent to its public works facility on Riverside Drive in exchange for the Bryan site, partial improvement of the Riverside site for district maintenance, and cash to make up the difference in value between the Bryan and Riverside sites and the loss of future use of the Bryan parcel. However, the city's October 20th proposal was only to purchase the Bryan parcel at its appraised value of $1.1 million. The district remains open to considering agreements on a case-by-case basis for city use of school district land for stormwater projects. The district's consideration of such projects will be influenced by, number one, the results of its current long-term facility planning process. The district must balance and give precedence to achievement of its core and educational mission over stormwater management issues. Number two, the Madison Stormwater Management Project. The stormwater project has been started and the IGA has been completed and the project has been started. The operation will be closely followed by the district. Number three, whether the city makes timely payments under the downtown tax increment financing agreement between the city and the district. While not connected directly to stormwater management projects, the district regards the city's willingness to abide by its intergovernmental agreements in general terms as a factor of assessing the likelihood of compliance with stormwater management agreements. It is the district's understanding that the city has delayed release of approximately $1.3 million in TIF funds to the district due to the city's dissatisfaction with the district's position on the Bryan parcel. Lastly, number four, last item to consider is the resolution of the city's high school stormwater fee claim. The city has periodically asserted the district owes the city $1.2 million for alternative stormwater projects arising from the reconstruction of York High School in 2004. The district disputes that it owes the city anything in regard to the York project. Even if the district has some obligation to the city, it amounts to no more than the deposit of up to $1.3 million in escrow for yet-to-be-determined projects to offset the stormwater impact from the reconstruction of York. This will need to be resolved before any negotiations over future stormwater management projects. The district will not accept the city's vague use of this claimed fee as a negotiating chip in connection with future stormwater management projects. The issue should be resolved or dropped by the city. The board reiterates its willingness to consider continued cooperation to help resolve the city of Elmhurst's stormwater management problems, but only consistent with its obligations to fulfillment of its core educational mission and to its taxpayers who live both in and outside of the city. Any discussion?
Thanks, Shannon, for delivering what is clearly the consensus of the board. And I think people should, I would request that people look closely at the statement that was delivered tonight. There's a lot there. One thing that I would highlight that isn't necessarily in there to the extent that some would prefer is to respond to allegations of delay by the school board. I think that's as unfair as it is inaccurate. The school district has not engaged in any delay. The school district's request, position in a comprehensive form, in a full agreement, has been with the city since June 20th. That's 4 months it's been there. And there have been several verbal responses, and the letter that just came in was the first written response that had a comprehensive nature, and as Shannon outlined it, it seems to be inadequate. Delay didn't happen. What really happened is I think that the city didn't like the price. And we believe that I'm speaking for myself, I believe it's a bit naive to believe that educational land is in some way available in an unfettered form for stormwater purposes without any countervailing costs whatsoever. Some people say, well, that's public land. Well, yes, it is public land. The public does own the property, and the public owns it for educational purposes for the kids. And there are true opportunity costs to our community in diverting the use of that land on a what is certainly a permanent basis away from the education of our kids. The district's request for compensation to the city was designed to reflect those costs. The community will suffer if it subordinates all interests to those of stormwater, especially where there is a detriment to our kids' education. Home values are connected to education as much as stormwater. I have used a poor expression in describing this. I said, we can walk and chew gum. What I'm trying to say there is that we can pursue two very important goals in this community at the same time. We can have the city fix the stormwater system while the school board preserves the educational system, including its physical resources available for the education of our kids. We need to resolve stormwater issues, but not in a single-minded fashion. We need to preserve these most excellent schools in our community because, in many ways, this is what's driving property values and protecting our most important investment. Those are my personal views that came out. I wanted to supplement what the consensus of the board is in the president's statement. And I appreciate your giving me the opportunity to do so.
Okay, any other board communication? Go ahead, Emily.
I just want to highlight part of the statement too, you know, like John did, but a different part, is that we, from the beginning, have been willing to work with the city. We want to help be part of the, you know, stormwater solution, but we've always said that we're not going to use school resources and we're not going to be in a worse off position because of it. And I think that's what your statement is saying tonight, is that, you know, the city offered to purchase school district property at the appraised value, and that would put us in a much worse position. You know, it would mean that we don't have anywhere to store the things that are currently stored there. It means that over an acre of land that's adjacent to Bryan Middle School would be gone, and that's just, you know, what your statement was saying. For all those reasons, we've been in a worse position. It doesn't mean that we're not willing to continue the conversation, that we're not willing to still, you know, do our part to work with the city. And in good faith, I think we all agree that we are willing to work with the city. But their terms were just, as you said, unreasonable.
Okay, any other board communication? Okay, upcoming meetings, November 15th, Board of Education meeting, November 29th, Special Board of Education meeting, 7 o'clock, and Tuesday, December 13th, Board of Education meeting. We've come to the end of the meeting. I declare the meeting adjourned.